Back for another in the shop video. So I'm actually going to be doing something in this video for a change, rather than showing you this and showing you that, which seems to be the scenario at the moment, because it's hard to do videos when I'm trying to do jobs. So you have to excuse me for the fact of that. When I'm trying to get work done, it's not easy to be shooting video. Even this is a job. It's not just something I'm doing for myself for fun. So anything that I'm doing in videos is always a customer job. I don't generally shoot anything that I'm doing other than my Mazak mission, which is back earlier in my channel, for those interested in looking at some silly guy rebuilding a CNC lathe. But as I said before, that's still sitting here. But not waste too much more time, just take you into this part now, or show you this part I should say, and try and get a little bit of video on this. I won't take you through the whole lot because it'll just drag on for too long, but just show you a little bit of it and just sort of maybe answer a few questions that seem to come up from time to time. So as you can see, obviously on the manual lathe today, not over on the CNC. I have a few jobs coming up on the CNC. I'm not sure if I'll get any video of it, but just some bushes and so on to do. So fairly large bushes, so we'll see how we go. But anything on the CNC lathe is about as exciting watching grass grow. The manual lathes always seem to get a bit more interest. Slide ways, always try to keep it fairly clean. Fairly difficult when especially when you're cutting hollow bar, you've got a lot of mill scale and things like that, so the bed does get fairly dirty. And even as much as I clean it, still gets covered in rubbish. And because I have it dripping in oil, everything just mixes together. So we've got it nice soaking wet in oil, as you can probably see on there. The material I'm cutting is 316 stainless, probably not the nicest thing to cut. It's coming down from 1 inch diameter, so back up here it's 1 inch diameter, and the customer needs an M22 three cutter, so standard pitch 2.5. I've already cut a taper on the end here, which was part of what they required. It's about a 5 degree taper on there. Well, it's worked out off measurement, but it works out to, it works out from 14 to the diameter of the base of the thread, which is 19.5 being 2.5. So that's already been done with the taper turning attachment you can see in the back there, and just holding between centers. So we're cutting from here, obviously, down to the other end. Fairly lengthy piece of material, only 22 mm diameter. I am expecting a bit of chatter, so we'll see how we go for the video. I'm not too sure how much of it I'll shoot. It's more so just trying to get it done because I've got a heap of other stuff to do, and I just thought this might be a good video where I'm actually doing something. From start to finish is 350 mm, or imperial language, about 14 inches, so a reasonable size thread. Compound around at the standard 29 degrees. You can cut threads. I normally, well, so in most of my videos I'm cutting straight in. I don't generally run the compound at 29 degrees, which is pretty much standard for cutting threads, I know, but something that a boss always hated me doing, but I've always sort of learned my own way of doing things, as you do. And the compound normally sits at 90 degrees to it. It's good for chasing up threads and things like that as well. So I know I need to recut threads, which is something I might include in a video later, how to recut threads. It might be something that I can do in a video. Just trying to think what else I was going to say. Normally, as I say, don't normally cut at that angle. It's a lot more to configure, but you do your own. You'll have to, I won't do any maths in it. That's up to you guys to work that out. I won't drag it on and show you the maths of how to cut depths of thread at 29 degrees. Have when you're feeding in, if you slide at 29 degrees, is a lot different than plunging directly in. Obviously, you're feeding in directly in. You're getting a readout from your digital readout or your screws on the side here, so, or your dials on the side here, so you're getting a readout from those, for those that don't have a dial indicator. I have a Swiss style tool post, as some people refer to them as, 40 position tool post, which is great, but it doesn't really fit very well with the percentages of that it's cutting, that it's set at. So I think it moves in 4 degree increments, I think, something like, I forgot there. So the tool sort of, you can see it's sort of tapered, so I had to sort of offset it in the tool post so it's at 90 degrees to the part. So if you do have one of these, you'll probably understand what I mean. It doesn't sort of work in that configuration of that 40 position, well, 40, 40 into 360, so whatever that works out to. So it's pretty easy math, but I won't worry about it because it's not the point of the video. Just wanted to show you cutting threads on stainless, which seems to be, well, cutting threads on a manual lathe is already, well, probably difficult for some people, I suppose, and stainless is probably stretching it that little bit further. There's a lot better metals to cut than this. I've even cut threads in titanium, and even that's better than cutting threads in stainless, especially 316. So I'll try and show, as I say, as much as I can. Chatter will probably be a problem, especially over that length as we start to get to midpoint, where it's wanting to push away on the tool a little bit. So I do about, just to give you an idea of how, so I won't, as I say, won't worry about depths and specs and things like that, but I do a finish cut and a spring cut to come back. So you want to try, and with stainless, one thing is trying to eliminate your sort of scrape cuts. You want to just really cut. You don't want it rubbing so much, because stainless, being the nature that it is, it work hardens. So if you are going to cut it, don't mess around. Don't be like working your way into it slowly. So know where your finished size is, and you want to pretty much hit it straight away, and then just come back with a light spring cut just to remove any, well, basically remove any burrs than actually removing material, because if you start rubbing anything, same as when you're drilling any type of, well, hard or hardenable types of steels, and if you're drilling them, they will start to harden if the drill stops cutting. And then once it hardens, it's very difficult to get the drill started again. And that's the same thing with stainless. And you probably don't want to be messing around trying to cut a thread at this length when the tool doesn't want to cut into it. So one other thing I probably want to cover is, I know there's a few guys out there still diehards for their high-speed steel. I've never liked high-speed steel for anything other than for drill bits and for custom grinding on, well, custom ground tools, when I have to grind a profile for an actual particular profile that I might want to cut, more so on the manual lathe. I mean, most of the profile stuff now is done on the CNC, but those one-off jobs where I need to cut pulleys and things like that, I need to cut a certain angle of V into the pulley, I'll grind a tool for that. High speed steel for that. Everything else, carbide. I've never loved high speed steel. It seems to be old school for me. And I'm not that young, but I know very well that pushing shit uphill, trying to cut hard metal with soft tools. Yeah, you can drill 316 with high speed steel drills, but it doesn't cut that well. Is you'll probably go and get a piece of 316, put it in the drill press, try and drill it, and you'll find out how difficult it is. I'm yabbering on a little bit at the moment as I'm doing videos, but I just wanted to cover some of the things that do come up about threading a little bit, but more so threading in stone, cutting OD threads in stone. So like tapping is a little bit different. There's a bit of a different nature because you've got variations of taps you can use for cutting OD threads. But OD threads, especially this length of thread, is a bit of a push. And it's not something I really want to say yes to, but it's for a customer. So what's actually for a customer, obviously. Someone's walked in and they've bought this piece of material in with a hand sketch of basically what they wanted. And now it's come over to me. One other thing I did forget to mention, I always put a relief cut in here. So where I park the tool, so when I'm coming along, it's just where I've got somewhere to park the tool. When you're engaged on the first cuts, it doesn't matter. But on your later cuts, when you're coming along, it just gives you somewhere to park the tool so you don't have to try and pull the tool out, especially where you're coming from. You've got that shoulder there where you've got 22 up to 25.4, which is the 1-inch size. So you might actually try and maybe pull the tool out in time. That's up to you, of course. It's a nice finish, but I normally always leave a relief in there where I park the tool and then just take my time. Half, run along, disengage half nut, out, wind it back, and because it's a metric machine, cutting metric thread, I don't have to power feed it back as we do with the Acme threads in a previous video. So I've talked enough about it. It was a fairly long intro, but there is a bit of information there talking about the job and some of the things to think about. It's more so an information video than a how-to video, but as with anything, don't be scared of something. Get out there and get it done. But it helps if you have the right tools, and messing around with things like high speed steel, trying to cut something like 316. Well, especially as I said, this length, forget about it. So you're just going to be shaking your head and thinking, why do I even get involved in this? Especially if someone's paying you for it, you've got to have the right gear. And I always use carboard, in indexable inserts anyway, so I don't mess around with high speed steel. At least if you can't justify indexable inserts, at least get some cemented in carboard tools if you're going to cut threads, especially. You don't want to be messing around sharpening tools as cutting threads as a tool's wearing. That's probably not a good thing. So, carbon insert will cut pretty much anything, except itself. Carbon won't cut carbon, but it'll cut pretty much any other metal. Pretty much. Enough of the bullshit now. Talking too much now, but just trying to get you sit back, and we'll do a couple of sizings cuts, and then just probably wind the video up. As always forget something, even though I'm yabbering a lot, I still forget stuff. Oil for lube, coolant if you like, preferably not for stainless especially, just straight oil, as I do with all my thread cutting, undiluted cutting oil. It's a full synthetic, being that it's less chance of bugs growing in it, well, pretty much zero chance of bugs growing in it, because it's a man-made oil, not a mineral oil, as with your old-style cutting oils that we've dealt with in the years past, where you have bugs growing in them and you finish up with dermatitis. So just one thing I just forgot to add, the oil that I've already sprayed on there with a little spray bottle, just coated the outside of the bar and just keep it coated as I'm working my way along, which you might see in the video. I'm not too sure how well this showed up. I'll get you set up on a tripod at the moment. We'll just do a run through just so that you guys watch it. The exciting part of an insert cut material. So up to the point where we've done our fairly reasonable size sizing cut, I'm pretty familiar with my lathe, so I know what it's doing as far as threads. I've cut a huge amount of threads on this machine, so I'm pretty comfortable with what it's setting. If whatever I'm setting it on, it's cutting that size, but doing the usual sanity check, so 2.5 gauge, just making sure that we're heading in the right direction. So, which is the general thing for those who might be not that familiar with, excuse me, nearly dropped the camera there. Slippery hands. So just the usual sanity check there. You probably don't normally cut that deep. That's a reasonable depth of cut. Normally you would just scratch it, but I didn't want to mess around. I really need to get moving on it. So that's my first cut there. Hopefully that glare's not getting in the way. I'll get my finger out of the way. But just checking that anyway, and make sure it's the same as the scale. Nothing worse than getting to the end of the thread and find out you didn't select the right dial on the machine then. And then you think you've done a great thread and then find out the nut doesn't go on. So just a little, as I say, a little sanity check with the gauge there. Make sure you choose the right one, 2.5. Hopefully it's 2.5, that is. And just to make sure. Should be 2.5. That would be a bit of a fool if I picked up the wrong gauge, wouldn't I? But I know the machine's set on the right pitch, so even if it isn't the right gauge. But anyway, I'll get you set up at some point, and then we'll get into it and try not to make the video too long, and just show you thread cutting on 316 stainless at a bit of a ridiculous length. So I got you propped up in a spot where you might be able to see anyway. You have to excuse the noise because the manual lathes aren't exactly the quietest things in the world. While that CNC is that much better, but hopefully there's more in it to see than hear. And anyway, might be able to dampen out my voice anyway from hearing me talking anyway. So we'll just do another run anyway. We'll just do this one, and I'll get back to the job, and I'll probably just knock it off of that just to show you the actual cutting anyway. So we're taking about, first two cuts we were taking about 0.2 a side, and then now we're just taking, I think it's about 0.1 per side. So as we're getting deeper in, we're just back off the depth of cut. I only get to do one part, so if I stuff it up, I'm going for a drive back to the stainless steel place. Pick up another piece of material because this has been supplied by my customer. So good, but good thing about customer supplied material, I don't have to worry about going to get anything. But if you stuff it up, you got to go and get another piece. So that's a bit of a nuisance. So I won't waste too much more time and get going, and hopefully not in my way as I try to kick out the half nut. So excuse the noise. Just get it fired up, spray heaps of oil on there, and keep it going as we're working our way along. So hopefully nothing goes wrong, like more than likely will with the camera pointed at it. was a bit of a worry at the end there if I can get my arm in there before, because the tripod was right where the tripod is where the half nut lever is. So I only managed just get my arm in there. That would have been good, wouldn't it? Get that on video, smashing the tool post into the chuck. But as you probably heard, got a few bit of harmonics around the middle here, an unsupported area. I could put a traveling steady on it, but all I do is just back off the feed. If it was chattering crazily, if it starts getting any worse, I'll put a traveling steady and just sit on that back side of it. Yeah, that's your versions with the bronze or brass inserts in them, so they're just controlling the chatter on there. I just take it out anyway, but any chatter that's in there, I should be able to get it out at the end anyway. I cut threads in stainless, but I can't say I've sort of cut threads this long in stainless anyway, and to this diameter too. You've sort of seen what was going on with it. Now we just back it up and keep going till we get to the finish, as I say. So a little bit of information there as far as depths and so on go, and just keep working it away. There's no set rule. It's just depending on your machine too, different machines will behave differently. This is a fairly heavy machine, around about probably just over 3 ton, I think this machine weighs. So it manages to dampen some of the sound, but some of you guys with smaller lathes, you might pick up a bit more chatter. But I doubt you'll be cutting anything this long as far as threads go, but you never know anyway. But that's thread cutting on 316, so that's nice and even. I'm not picking up any fur on there at the moment. There's no sharp edges on there. I just rub my finger on there. That's nice and even on there. Yeah, it's going to come out a nice thread. So just take our time and just get towards the end of the job, and hopefully you enjoyed the video and not made it too long for you. If you've got any questions, just let me know in the comments, and I'll talk to you guys soon. Okay, bye-bye for now.